Hey everyone, Nick Velezzo, hopeless, extremely hopeless guitar enthusiast with you once again. And speaking of hopeless, have I got a story for you. I'm always intrigued when a vintage guitar story makes the mainstream media. And just recently we had a story that broke from, you guessed it, Gibson Guitars. Who else? Gibson announced on their website recently that they're offering a $59,000 reward for some missing shipping ledgers. So you might be wondering, what exactly are these missing documents and why is Gibson willing to pay so much to get them back? Now, when I first saw this article, I freaked out because, as you might know, I'm a bit of a vintage guitar nerd. And whenever you read about the golden era of guitars, this infamous little gap in Gibson's records keeps popping up. Now, I did first see this on a guitar forum, but they were sharing an article in the Wall Street Journal. So this is not just a story relegated to the guitarosphere. It's been featured in Forbes, numerous newspapers across the country, and of course it's made all the music publications like Rolling Stone, but this is definitely a story that's made mainstream news. So what's so important about these documents that it would make the news? These ledgers come from arguably the most important era of guitar making, an era that influenced how guitars were made the world over. And it's undoubtedly the most pivotal part of Gibson's 120 plus year existence. The guitars shipped during this missing 2.5 year period are probably the very reason that Gibson guitars exist to this day. Now, there appears to be a lot of confusion and debate over the bounty for these missing ledgers, and I wanted to try to clear some of that up, or at least set the record crooked permanently. So if you're watching this video, I'll warn you, this is not going to be just a little 3-minute summary of what Gibson said in their PR. This is going to dive deep into the search for these missing ledgers. So, warning, extreme guitar nerd content following. So if you are here watching this video, I wanted to explain what Gibson might be looking for, why it's significant, if there's a chance it still exists, some theories of what maybe happened to it, and also why there's a little bit of, say, controversy surrounding this search. Because after all, whenever you're talking about missing or potentially stolen documents and very valuable collectible items, there seems to be a bit of, dare I say, guitar espionage at play. Or as I like to call it, guitar espionage. Now first, let me read the actual statement on Gibson's website. Can you find the missing ledger? $59,000 reward for safe return of 1959 to 1960 Gibson shipping ledger. We would like your assistance in recovering our missing shipping ledger book from 1959 to 1960, which documents an important period in our 126-year-old history and the pinnacle of the Gibson golden era. The 1959 Gibson shipping ledger has been missing from Gibson's archives for at least 30 years. It may not have made the move with the company from Kalamazoo, Michigan to Nashville, Tennessee. If you believe you have it, please follow the steps below. Upon a validation of ledger authenticity, the party who safely returns the missing 1959 to 1960 shipping ledger book will receive a $59,000 cash reward. Now it goes on to list their process, the email, how they evaluate the submissions. You can go on the website and look that up yourself. But after the instructions, it has this. We are also seeking to recover other pre-1970 Gibson documents, ledger books, blueprints, and unique Gibson assets which are historically important and relevant. So they're not just looking for this missing shipping ledger, seems that there might be some other little gaps in their documentation from this era. In an article with the Oakland Press, Gibson's chief merchant officer, Caesar Goykin, says flat out that he thinks that these ledgers might have been stolen. So in addition to this missing ledger, there is probably a good chance that there's plenty of other Gibson ephemera from that period that was also stolen. Now there have been rumors in the guitar world for decades that when Gibson began transferring operations from their original plant in Kalamazoo, Michigan, to their current plant in Nashville, Tennessee, starting in the 1970s, that things started to walk out the door. Unused pickups, various parts, templates, documents were all smuggled out of the Gibson plant. On top of that, when Gibson decided to permanently shut down operations in Kalamazoo in 1984, they auctioned off literally tons of factory goods, ranging from necks and bodies, guitar parts, templates, full machinery, hand tools, you name it. So no one is exactly sure, but it's thought that sometime in the late 70s and early 80s, is when these shipping ledgers went missing. So what exactly are these missing documents? What information do they contain? And what might they look like? In my continuing research on the Gibson Explorer, I found some information in Tony Bacon's book about that model from former Gibson historian Walter Carter. Carter explains that Gibson actually used two primary sets of logs. One was the serial number log. This log has every single serial number in numerical order, along with other pertinent information like the model and the date it shipped. Carter claims that these lists were stamped and logged as the guitars were made, but there are plenty of entries where there's blank spots after the serial numbers, so we can assume that these lists might have been pre-stamped in anticipation of production, but these guitars were actually never made. Or maybe they forgot to log that particular guitar. The second set of logs are what are referred to as the daybooks. Now, this is the missing ledger that Gibson's referring to in their search. The daybooks record every instrument that left the factory that day in chronological order. Now, we're talking everything here. Solid bodies, thin lines, arch tops, acoustics, amplifiers, even repairs. Anything that left that factory with a Gibson serial number on it was marked into this ledger. Now, Gibson has released pictures of existing ledgers that they have in their possession, and we can see that the book will list the model number, followed by the serial number, and usually its destination. It also may contain special notes like if there was a special finish or some custom ornamentation. Gibson's statement reads, the missing shipping ledgers from 1959 and 1960. But Gibson actually only has the daybooks through Monday, April 30th, 1958. Now the numerical log, or the serial log, begins again in 1961 when they implemented a new numbering system that impressed the serial number into the wood as they do today. Gibson is not only missing the daybooks or the shipping ledger, there is also no serial log for their ink-stamped solid body electric guitars from the same period. They still have the serial log for the A-list serial numbers or the artist serial numbers. These are for all the hollow bodies. This includes the acoustics, the arch tops, the semi-hollows, including the ES series. Now, Gibson doesn't mention any specific details on these documents in any of their PR. Are there any mention of there being two potentially missing documents? So maybe these two logs were bundled together, or perhaps they'll provide more information and details in further press releases. So if you're already into guitars, there's no mystery why this 2.5 year gap in their records is so important. It's pretty much the exact period that all of the Les Paul Standard Sunbursts were made. Probably the most sought after and most valuable guitars on the planet. This one short-lived model pretty much single-handedly makes up the entire legacy of Gibson. Now, of course, they've made plenty of other great guitars, some very iconic models in their own right, but they're always overshadowed in the wake of the burst. Every year, Gibson makes thousands upon thousands of Les Paul model guitars. Retired CEOs and investment bankers and hedge fund managers line up to purchase the latest $25,000 59 reissue Les Paul that's hand-painted and aged with a certificate of authenticity signed by Jimmy Page and farted on by Billy Gibbons and peed on by Rick Nielsen. Time moves on, production has gone up, prices keep climbing, and yet guitarists and collectors alike just can't seem to cure their burst fever. And Gibson pretty much has no record of shipping any of those original guitars. Considering how important this guitar is to Gibson and to guitarists the world over, this missing document is not only extremely valuable to the company, it's an important historical document to music history. In fact, I would argue that if Gibson had been missing all of their shipping ledgers except for this one, we might not even bother looking for the other ledgers at all. If Gibson could actually get their hands on this ledger, it would answer a lot of questions. How many bursts were built? Where did each guitar ship to? Were any shipped to a celebrity? Which guitars were ordered with custom features or finishes? Now, Gibson continually looks back at original examples of these guitars to get ideas for future builds or to create reissues of specific models. In fact, in the Guitar.com article about the missing shipping ledger, Cesar Goykin mentions that they're actually going to look for special examples in the ledger to create these reissues of these special one-off guitars. So it'd be really nice to know that if Gibson does have one of these original bursts in their possession, to know that it's actually legit and not just a well-done fake. Because the bursts are not just the most valuable guitars on the face of the planet, they're also the most commonly copied guitars of all time. When you have a guitar that's in such high demand, with demand increasing almost every year, With the original supply so limited, it's inevitable that some copycats will show up. For decades, skilled luthiers, and not so skilled ones, have been making so-called tributes, or replicas, of fabled Gibson bursts. Often, these were builders who had their hands on originals and could study every nook and cranny and were known for their skills and sought after to build copies for fans who either couldn't afford an original burst or simply just couldn't get their hands on one. It's also thought that some burst owners had copies or replicas made of their burst so they didn't have to take their valuable guitars out to play. On top of this, when the burst craze first hit in the late 60s, players and luthiers started to do what was called a burst conversion. Now, there are plenty of older 1950 Gibson Les Paul gold tops with P90 pickups out there. Out of a lust for owning a burst, many of these older gold tops had their finishes stripped and they were refinished in a cherry sunburst. They also had hardware switched out and they even routed the pickup cavities so they can install humbuckers. Now, these conversions are still done to this very day. And in fact, some builders go as far as taking an old slab body Junior, adding a maple top to it, and using it as a husk to create some sort of mutant burst. Now, ever since the early 70s, the value of these original bursts have just skyrocketed like crazy. And with asking prices today of around $200,000 to $250,000 for decent examples, and sometimes up to twice that for very prime examples, ones in good condition with no repairs or a really high figured maple top, or maybe some celebrity provenance. So it's easy to see why there might be some good money in faking a burst. Now, this is where the search for the missing ledger gets a little bit controversial amongst folks in the guitar community. And when I say the guitar community, I mean overweight bearded nerds wearing black t-shirts posting on guitar forums. Plenty of fakes do exist, and there have been rabid collectors who have been duped into paying big time money for some of these replica bursts. When I say big time money, I mean like $500,000. Burst copies are so prevalent that it's thought that more than half of the ones that come up for appraisal end up being fakes. There's a joke that always gets told about the burst that says something like, it's estimated that only 1,200 original Les Paul sunbursts were ever made, of which only about 2,000 survive to this day. There is a thought that if this shipping ledger ever comes to light, it may delegitimize many guitars that people thought were the real deal. Now, I really don't know who to believe on this, but it's estimated that there are literally hundreds, if not thousands, of replicas or fakes out there. And when I say fakes, I mean guitars built or modified to pass as an original 59 Les Paul. So let's just say hypothetically speaking, there are 12, just 12 of these guitars in the hands of collectors and players that are very, very good fakes. So good that they even passed the scratch and sniff test from several respected appraisers. Now, if these guitars have an average value of, say, $250,000 each, these 12 guitars, these 12 fakes, have a collective value or perceived value of $3 million. Now, just imagine there are actually two dozen fakes, or maybe 100 of these out there. Well, you get the picture. So even though $59,000 seems like a pretty good bounty on some missing papers, many guitar nerds think that that amount is laughable. Recovery of this document might be worth way more. In fact, at least another zero more in some folks' eyes. If these ledgers still exist, it might be worth more to keep them in hiding, or dare I say, destroy them altogether. I love the way guitar nerds talk about this because it's almost like there's some international underground high-end counterfeit guitar cabal that specializes in pushing high quality fakes onto unsuspecting wealthy buyers. There's some nefarious character with the missing shipping book and he's pulling out unused serial numbers to commission yet another fake to sell to a very wealthy and gullible collector. Now, I'm sure there are some rather unscrupulous guitar dealers out there. I know there are. I'm not saying this doesn't happen. I'm not saying that fakes aren't made to deceive a buyer. It's been done, and there may be some secrets that you have to keep in the vintage guitar buying circle on top of it. I also think that there were some replicas made without any ill intent, but eventually it gets into someone else's hands, and then someone else's hands, and then it gets into the hands of some scumbag, and then the provenance of that guitar gets twisted around. You know what I'm talking about, all these stories you hear. How many times have you heard the story of the church lady who bought it and then just played it on Sunday and put it in the case? or the kid who bought the guitar in the early 60s, and then he got drafted into Nam, killed in action, the parents were grieving, they didn't touch his room, and it stayed underneath his bed until 30 years later. I do think fakes are out there, and people may be afraid to find out that they have something that's fraudulent. But personally, I feel, wouldn't you want to know? If you own guitars that were worth six figures, or you paid six figures for them, would it be nice to see a document from the manufacturer that has record of your serial number being legit? I know I would. I can see where this potentially can open up a can of worms. If all of a sudden it turns out there are 100 Bursts that were purchased for big money and not being fakes, think of the potential lawsuits. Think of the dealers and the collectors whose reputation would be potentially ruined if they found out that they were selling faked goods, even if they believed the guitars that they were selling were totally legit. Now, even most of the folks buying these guitars had plenty of money and they wouldn't feel a dent, so to speak, from the instant deflation, they certainly have the legal power to go after someone. Now, as a guitar nerd who doesn't have the money to actually afford these vintage guitars, yet...
You'll never afford it! Live in the now!
It will be mine.
I'd love to see how finding this missing document might unfold and affect both the vintage guitar and current guitar markets. I mean, just imagine it. Gibson creates a reissue of a specific Burst for big money. The ledger shows up and that serial number doesn't show up in the books. And now it's thought to be a fake. Well, how do folks feel about buying genuine replicas of a fake? Now, so far through this entire video, I've been talking about nothing but Bursts. But for me personally, I'm way more interested in seeing if these documents would shed any light on the Carina guitars. Even more rare and mysterious than the Bursts are the Gibson Explorer and Flying V guitars. Up until June 30th, 1958, when that shipping ledger stops, 52 Flying Vs were recorded leaving the factory, but not one Explorer. Now, it's thought that just 22 original Gibson Explorers had left the factory by 1959, but to complicate matters, leftover parts Explorers were shipped in the early 60s, and these often have 1958 serial numbers on them, even though they were obviously outfitted with early 60s hardware and electronics. And like the Les Paul, the Explorer is a very copied guitar. Due to its rarity and small production numbers, there's probably many more replicas out there than there are legit examples. And because there are so few in circulation and coupled with vintage guitar mania, originals have sold for huge money. They don't often come up for sale, but original Explorers have sometimes broken the $500,000 mark, and possibly one is even sold for over $1 million. And with these leftover Explorers that are thought to have been shipped in around 1963, it's very difficult to determine what is real without any documentation. So here's an example. Everyone knows Rick Nielsen, right? Guitars for Cheap Trick and Vintage Guitar Nutcase. He holds the distinction of owning two original Gibson Carina Explorers. Well, maybe three. He's not sure if one's legit. And yes, I know there's another collector who might own a majority of the original Explorers. But anyways, one of Rick's prize Explorers has a serial number of 8-1008. However, this predates all other known Explorer serial numbers. The earliest known Explorer, at least by serial number, is 82142, the forked headstock model that was owned by Rick Derringer. Because of the unusual headstock that was found on the Futura prototypes, it is thought that this guitar might also be a prototype. Now, it's entirely possible that this guitar was stamped with an earlier serial number and shipped at a later date. On BurstSerial.com, a site devoted to logging the late 1950s Les Paul standards, there is an early 58 gold top Les Paul with the same exact serial number as Rick's Explorer, 81008. Now, I haven't asked Gibson because, quite frankly, it's not any of my business, but the ledgers that they currently have should theoretically show when that gold top shipped. So, did Gibson accidentally double the serial number on two different models? Is the gold top a fake? Is Rick's Explorer a fake? If these ledgers ever showed up, it'd be interesting to see if this serial number was recorded once or twice, or even worse, never at all. But given that both guitars are worth big money as they are, I'm sure neither owner would like to admit to owning a fake and being duped. And a similar situation could potentially arise with other guitars. So if the Bursts and the Explorers and the Flying Vs weren't enough, there's another big reveal that this ledger could potentially show. Of course, I am talking about the Bigfoot of vintage guitars, the fabled Modern. The Modern is the third of the modernistic guitars that Gibson patented in the late 1950s. Now, we know for sure that a patent of the body style existed, but it's been hotly debated if an actual physical Modern ever did exist. There have been reports by some who have claimed to have seen it. Billy Gibbons claims to own one or two, but he won't show anyone. Luthier Dan Earlywine had the possession of a modified Modern in Michigan near Ground Zero in the 1970s, but this was later dismissed by George Grun, but then it was swept up by a Japanese collector. Shortly thereafter, Ibanez started producing their own version of the guitar. The recovery of these missing shipping ledgers might prove that the Holy Grail, the Bigfoot of vintage guitars, may actually exist. However, Modern was sort of a nickname bestowed on the model, and it was probably never put in any kind of full-fledged production. So, therefore, even if we had the ledgers, it'd probably be difficult to identify this guitar if it did even ship. More questions that may arise if these actual ledgers do show up, but we'll never know until they actually surface. The other part of this argument is, what are the chances that this document still exists if it ever did exist? First, I will address if this document did ever exist. I do believe some record of the shipping ledger had existed at some point, but here's where it gets a bit tricky. So remember when I mentioned earlier that there's actually two primary logs that Gibson kept? One was the serial number log and the other was the daybooks. Well, we know for a fact that the daybooks they have up until June 30th, 1958, and that there are serial logs for the A-list numbers through 1960, thus for the hollow body guitars. But Walter Carter mentioned that there are no daybook shipping ledgers for the 1960s, only serial number logs. 1961 is when these serial numbers logs pick up again for the solid bodies, and by that time the Les Paul had changed to the new SG body style. However, two interesting points that I'm trying to find out here. Is there a solid body serial number log prior to July 1958? I've seen no mention of the serial number log lists for solid bodies prior to the missing ledger date. I assume they exist, I don't know for sure. However, they absolutely do exist for the ES guitars and other hollow bodies. Now, on top of this, it's also been reported that last day book, the last shipping ledger, which stops on June 30th, 1958, has a bunch of blank pages left in the book. So that day was not the last day in that book. They didn't run out of room. It appears that entries were deliberately stopped from being entered into that day book after that date. So it leaves me to wonder, how many documents are there? So we've got the daybooks, the shipping ledger that records everything that left the factory each day in chronological order up until July 1st, 1958. Then we know we have the serial logs for the A-list serial number instruments, which list every serial in numerical order with information filled in as they were being built. But how about other serial logs? Was there one for the solid bodies? How about one for lap steels, banjos, amplifiers? From my understanding, what Walter Carter says is the day book or the shipping ledger was discontinued in 1961, and it appears that the serial number log features all instruments consolidated into one list. So I've even seen Epiphone models and ES models alongside SGs on these lists. So this leaves that 2.5 year gap, this area where we are unsure if any of these documents even existed. Did the ledger stop on July 1st of 1958? Was there a separate numerical serial log list started for the solid bodies with the ink stamp serial numbers on that date? Was there a shipping ledger for this period and no numerical list for the solid bodies? I do believe that some sort of documentation had to have existed for several reasons. First, Gibson is filling orders placed by their salespeople and Gibson dealers. Any manufacturer, no matter what goods they're selling, they're either going to invoice the customer after the goods have shipped or on a specific date each month. But most of the larger manufacturers, and this is how Gibson and Fender and the big makers do to this day, is that they have a consignment inventory. This means that the dealer may pay the manufacturer after the goods are sold to the end user or the customer like you and me. I absolutely believe that some sort of list had to be kept in order to keep track of everything that left the door for Gibson's billing department to send out the invoices and account for incoming payments. Secondly, Gibson offers a warranty on all their products. If you look at the 1959 Gibson catalog, it says, Every Gibson instrument is backed up by a lifetime guarantee. To this very day, Gibson offers this warranty to the original owner. They also asked that this guitar be registered with the manufacturer. I would think that they would definitely keep a log for warranty repair considerations. The third reason that I believe that these documents or some sort of shipping ledger existed is the fact that there is also a third document that Gibson used to record sales. At the end of each year, Gibson made a tally of every model sold. I'm assuming that someone, by hand, looked over the entire shipping ledgers and marked how many guitars were shipped for each particular model. Now, Gibson still has possession of these year-end tally sheets, including the years 1958, 59, and 60. So I'm going to take a guess that someone just didn't make up the numbers and enter in the totals and actually had a document to read. And it's this third list, this tally sheet, where you can get an estimation of how many Les Paul Sunbursts were produced. At the end of 1958, it was documented that 434 Les Pauls were shipped from the factory, 643 were shipped in 1959, and 635 in 1960. However, the total for the year 1958 accounted for both gold tops and sunbursts shipped, and it's believed that more than half of those were actually gold tops. And the 1960 totals include some of the SG style bodies that were shipped towards the end of the year. So the only total that we can assume are all sunburst Les Pauls are the 643 from 1959. Given known examples, it's estimated that anywhere from 12 to 1400 bursts were actually made. Oh, how that missing shipping ledger would really shed some light on this and firm up that number. So I believe without a doubt that some sort of ledger had to have existed during this period. However, the other part of this is, what are the chances that it does still exist? Well, a lot of people think that it was quite simply thrown out by Gibson. And I think there is a very high chance that this is true. Now, my day job, I work for a manufacturer's representative of plumbing supplies. Now, we're always dealing with catalogs and price lists and cut sheets for new products or updated products. And it's not unusual for us to throw away boxes and boxes of these because there's always a price increase, even sometimes twice a year, or there's updated models or discontinued models. So we don't want that old material and that old documentation getting out into our customers' hands. I very well could see Gibson at any time looking at an old catalog or an old price list and just throwing everything out because it was really of no use to him. So it's highly possible that during a paperwork purge, this shipping ledger got swept up and thrown into the dumpster. However, I really do believe if it was thrown out, that it was done completely on accident. Like I mentioned before, Gibson offered warranties on their guitars. And Gibson has shipping ledgers that go back to the 1930s, maybe even earlier. It seems weird that they would just decide to throw out this one ledger. Now, it's possible that someone pulled the ledger one day for a burst owner to verify it and just put it in the wrong spot, and then another day the manager says, hey, throw out all this stuff, and it actually got swept up. But it's really peculiar that this one ledger out of all of them is the one that went missing. People have argued that, oh, the Les Paul was such a huge failure that it didn't matter and they just threw out the book because it wouldn't have mattered anything to them anyways. But that is not true, because this shipping ledger had everything on it, including the juniors, which were a really good seller, and also the high-end guitars, the Super 400s, the Birdland, all these really, really high-end guitars, stuff that people were paying comparably $4,000, $5,000, $6,000 in the day, and were never huge sellers and never intended to be. They probably knew the significance of holding on to those documents. Just like in my business, even though we throw out stuff, we know that we have to keep engineering drawings and parts breakdowns of old products because our companies go back 100 years and we always have to retrofit or repair very old items. Gibson knew the importance of those documents. And also, the burst really caught on quite quickly. It was only about 4 or 5 years ahead of its time. So there was never a short enough gap there where it's like, oh, well, that was a failure, let's throw it all out. That's really just, it's not thinking how a company thinks. So yes, it might have been thrown out on accident. However, there's a very, very good chance that this ledger was deliberately stolen. Like I'd mentioned before, it's thought that a lot of stuff started to walk out the door when they were making the transition from Kalamazoo to Nashville, Tennessee. It could have been an old, disgruntled employee that knew that they were eventually going to lose their job, but it also might have been done out of sort of a preservation sake, because they figured when they move out of here, they're probably going to throw a lot of this stuff away, or it's going to get locked up in a room and forgotten. And they wanted to keep this record because they knew it was important. They didn't want to see it get lost. Also, it's quite possible that this ledger got thrown in with a bunch of stuff at those auctions in 1984. It could be in the hands of an unsuspecting non-guitarist, you know, someone who just was a local Kalamazoo resident and wanted to get a little piece of the local history. I know people like that. When a business gets shut down, they want to get a stone or a piece of documentation of that hometown's history and legacy. And that's what I think is very interesting about this search. Yeah, it's a PR move. Someone pointed out that, oh, $59,000 reward, like a 59 Les Paul. It's kind of cute. But they're getting it out there. They're getting it out there into the open to the public. So maybe there is somebody who has this ledger, but it's an unsuspecting person. It's someone outside of the guitar realm. It's someone that might be a relative, a descendant of a Gibson employee that has it in their stuff. So if it's not in the hands of some nefarious ne'er-do-well who is using it to fake guitars, it might be a really good bounty, a $59,000 bounty, to someone who doesn't know anything about guitars at all. So is this search even worth it? What do you think? Do you think that something might show up, or do you think that they're gone forever? What do you think happened to it? Is $59,000 a big enough reward? I'd be interested to hear what you have to say. Comment below. Especially if you have any other information or insight, I'd love to hear it. At the very least, even if this shipping ledger doesn't show up, I'd be very interested to see what other kinds of stuff, what kind of catalogs or pamphlets. There's all sorts of publications, you know, Gibson Gazette, that would have, you know, that they would put out there. So maybe there are some other rare documents that the guitar community doesn't even know about that might come to light. I'd be very interested to see that and see how this plays out. But one thing is for certain, if this shipping ledger does turn up, I look forward to the Gibson Custom Shop Limited Edition 1959 shipping ledger in genuine leather, aged by Tom Murphy, with heavy stock maple sheets, and our vintage original NOS 50s ink. I'll be ready to purchase the authentic ledger reissue. I can't believe I spent so much time talking about this. I've wasted my life.